Hello everyone, I'm Shael Morg. Today I want to talk to you about logging and how you too can save the earth by logging better. In my debugging book, I talked quite a bit about logging because logging is precognitive debugging. We write the information we would want around when we will debug a failure later on. There's nothing like logs when things get tough in production. There are other ways to debug in production, but logs are often some of the best ways. If debugging is like solving a crime, logging is our trail of clues, so we're both Sherlock and the criminal, but we're also the people who left clues along the way to solve the mystery. Unfortunately, we aren't strategic enough about the clues, and they are often quite terrible. I might write the best logs in the world. Spoiler, I don't. But here's the thing. Even if I'm good, I'm part of a team. And a team is only as good as its weakest link. If one of us sees logs in one light and my teammate takes a different approach, we'll have terrible results. Bad logging doesn't mean not logging enough. On the contrary, it's often logging too much. This was discussed a while back in Reddit, and I love this quote from one of the posters. A team just set the log level too high and burned through $100,000. This is a very common scenario, although this is indeed extreme. Overlogging can kill projects, companies, jobs, and the rainforest. The amount of pollution produced by overlogging and wasted resources is absolutely fantastic. The cost is probably the point that will resonate the most. Overlogging can quickly drain an account. Overlogging kills the performance of your app. Your app might respond instantly with level 2 cache hits, but if it has a log, then it has I/O and performance can tank. When debugging, we need to look at logs in context. That's crucial. We need to understand the flow of the application. Overlogging creates noise that makes the reading experience painful. We can miss important details or take ages to track the important bits through all the redundant logs. To me, the biggest problem with overlogging is the environment. A server runs 24/7 and takes up electricity all the time. The more of them we have around and the more activity we have, the more carbon we put out. Allocating these resources is easy, but the carbon footprint is huge. The problem is it goes both ways. The exact opposite is a major problem. Without the right logs, we can end up stuck. We don't understand the fix we need to do and can't help users. We can lose revenue. Worse, to get the right log, we start adding new logs and enter the CI/CD cycle of death. Add a log, go through PR, merge, production, reproduce the problem, find out you still don't have enough data. Rinse, repeat, forever. At least, that's how it feels. Can you imagine the costs and carbon footprint of a process like that? It might be worse than some cases of overlogging. How do we solve this? We need to adopt common guidelines within each company that detail how logs should be written, what constitutes good logging, and what's bad. Pretty much every company I ever worked for had a coding guidelines discussing indentation and formatting. Almost no company had a standard for logging. I'd argue that logging is far more important and has more impact on the quality of your code than indentation or formatting. We need a document we can refer to in code reviews So the team works coherently to produce a unified code base that's easy to debug and isn't wasteful. I want to say first, these are suggestions. For every suggestion, there are exceptions. That's fine. My goal is to help you think about it. You need to develop standards within your organization so that code reviews will define what's good and bad logging, not based on the taste of a specific reviewer. These are my opinions and preferences. Take the things you like and add what you like. Throw away the stuff you disagree with, but provide reasons for every rule. Don't write a custom logger. This seems simple enough. There are enough loggers out there. Seriously, don't reinvent the wheel. But this also applies to abstractions. I see developers wrap loggers with their own wrapper. This doesn't make sense. The value of using a standard is that third-party libraries can also use the standard. They don't use the abstraction, and you would end up with an abstraction on top of an abstraction that serves no purpose. People sometimes write a lot in the log messages. This hurts readability and adds costs to ingestion. Keep the log to the point. Logs must be clearly unique. Use search and see if there's a log that's even similar in the code. If there is, it might cause a problem in 2 a.m. when you're reviewing a log and looking at the wrong line. Logs and loops are both verbose and hit you in terms of performance. You might think your loop doesn't go too high, but things might change and blow up your log. This is generally a bad idea. Log before the loop or after the loop, never in the loop itself. A list or an array can grow. Even if it's small right now, you can easily blow up the log with unreadable data. This is almost as bad as logging in a loop and suffers from the same problems. Don't invoke code to perform a log. A simple example is this. I invoke a method to fetch additional data. This might have low overhead right now and might be read-only right now, but with project changes, the method might have more overhead and might even change application state in subtle ways. Logs must never impact state, even if you can turn them off. You don't want a case where something only works with logs turned on. Only log variables. Never invoke code to perform logging. One of the workarounds is a callback interface. If a log is filtered out, the callback interface isn't invoked, and this produces less overhead. But that's still bad. We can still impact performance when the log is included. So we're just hiding the problem a bit. I see people logging the time or the current thread when both of these are usually printed for every log line. If you have MDC, then you might have additional metadata that you shouldn't log. This is just wasteful and confusing. I suggest having one log per method at most. This is obviously open to debate, and there are exceptions. But too many logs in a method will make combing through the logs difficult. So if we have one point to place the log, where should we put it? Right before the return, so we can include the return value as part of the log. When you analyze a log, the return value from the method is often some of the most valuable information there is. Some developers only read the log when they have a failure. They search and leave. Don't do that. Try reading it like a book. It should tell a story. If it doesn't, you need to fix the log so the flow is obvious when filtering for a single user. SREs will need to go over these things, and if the log is inconsistent or weird, they can miss an important detail. Furthermore, you might notice errors that are marked incorrectly or for which you didn't get a notification. That's very important. Put it in your calendar and make sure to read a log on a regular basis. I sometimes see log messages marked as warnings that should be info level and vice versa. I go with error for crucial failure, warning for important problematic information, info for general important details, and debug for the extra mile information that's normally disabled. When running in production, I typically set the log level to warning. I want to reduce ingestion costs and use the log ingestion if there's something I need to know. I think keeping this log level forces us to really think about what we need in production and helps reduce costs. One of the things we often do is run tests with debug logging while deploying production with a different level. That's a mistake. It might create a situation where the higher volume of logs impacts the result, like race condition, etc. We also need to make sure we can fix a bug with warnings alone. Otherwise, some info logs might need to move to warning level. Ingestion integration tests sometimes verify against the log information. That's risky, fragile, and problematic. We shouldn't do that. Avoiding a double log seems obvious, but it isn't always. Case in point, this sample. We log an error on catch, seems right and intuitive, but the generic error handling code should probably do the logging. In that case, the error will be logged twice with no actual benefit. If you were impacted by log4j, then this should be obvious. Any user submitted data should be sanitized before logging. This invariably means that we will have some unlogged information, but this is probably better than the alternative. Tools like SonarQube automatically detect problematic logging like that. Personally identifiable information is a huge issue. You can inadvertently log a credit card number when printing an object and accidentally violate regulations. PII Reduction lets you define masks that would remove such accidental logging. Map Diagnostic Context, also known as MDC, lets us assign context to logging operations. This is a bit harder with asynchronous APIs, but is available there too. So if you have a log, you can also add the web request that triggers it to the MDC. Then, when you look at the log in a viewer tool, you can see the context of the request. I can place the current user ID and a lot of other metadata there, but I probably shouldn't. What matters would typically be request URI, user host, user ID, and transaction ID if applicable. Sometimes people add a lot of data into the MDC, and that's a problem in terms of performance and data storage. Setting the MDC values is a painful and sensitive process. I suggest using one class to encapsulate that entire logic instead of spreading it in the code. This way you can keep track of what goes into the MDC and make global decisions on adding or removing information. MDC is problematic. When it fails in JVM apps prior to Loom, we need to use thread pools so we can clean the MDC information before recycling the threads. This is a sensitive issue with MDC, and you need to make sure this is enforced. Personally, I'm not a big fan of asynchronous logging. If you log so much you need asynchronous logging, then perhaps you have other problems. For all of these points, I want to drill in two. You need to define a log standard for your company. Otherwise, in code review, you'll get a mess of opinions and a bad result. It's like your team writing a book. Too many authors create something that's very hard to read. Code review will help align these. Please check out my book and follow me for more videos like this. Thank you.